Hello employers, SQL is receiving numerous inquiries from clients asking about the impact of the new code on wages 2019 on the company's compliance. Just to recap, the central government has notified the code on wages with effect from 8th August 2019 and has recently put the draft rules also in the public domain. Sweeping compliance changes have been made to the definition of wages, bonus, definition of contractor and contract labor, fines and penalties, and full and final payment of wages. Undoubtedly, the code on wages is big news for HR, legal, payroll, and compliance teams. In case you would like a full-fledged opinion from SQL, please contact us on the email info@sql.com or call us on the numbers provided in the description box below. The Code on Wages 2019 unifies five acts into one comprehensive code, namely the Payment of Wages Act, the Minimum Wages Act, the Payment of Bonus Act, the Equal Remuneration Act. Earlier acts were vaguely made applicable to industrial or other establishments, creating confusion. Now the 2019 code uses the term establishment to mean any place where any industry, trade, business, manufacture or occupation is carried on, thus extending the application to commercial establishments as well. Clearly, everyone's included in this compliance. The code provides for separate definitions of a worker and employee. The definition of employee is broader than that of worker, as it includes persons carrying out managerial and administrative work. The definition of worker, however, expressly includes working journalists and sales promotion employees. Previously, the Payment of Wages Act was applicable only to employees drawing wages below 24,000 per month. However, the code makes no mention of any such threshold, and it appears to be applicable to all employees across the board. Accordingly, the code has raised the responsibility of an employer to ensure proper wage structuring and timely payment of such wages to all its employees, including bonus and full and final settlement. Further, there are some other noteworthy changes. Provisions relating to equal remuneration. The code directs the third gender, that is transgenders, to also be protected from discrimination in remuneration for similar work. Provisions relating to minimum wages. Unlike the Minimum Wages Act, which is only applicable to scheduled employments, the wage code extends to all employments in the organized or the unorganized sector. The definition of contractor and contract labor has undergone a paradigm change. Contractor now includes anyone who supplies contract labor for any work of the establishment as mere human resource and includes a subcontractor. Contract labor does not include a worker who is regularly employed by the contractor for any activity of his establishment, and his employment is governed by mutually accepted standards of employment, and who gets periodical increments, social security, and other benefits. Radical, isn't it? Bonus features also changed. Bonus shall be paid to every employee drawing specific wages as per notification. Where the wages of the employee exceeds threshold amount, the bonus payable to such employee shall be calculated as per the wage ceiling or the minimum wage, whichever is higher. Hence, the earlier limit of 21,000 for payment of statutory bonus stands removed. Annual minimum bonus of 8.33% shall be payable whether or not the employer has any allocable surplus during the previous accounting year. Any demand for excess bonus, either on the basis of production or productivity, shall be determined by an agreement or settlement between the employer and the employees, subject to the condition that the total bonus, including the annual minimum bonus, shall not exceed 21% of the wages earned by the employee in the accounting year. The definition of wages now has three parts to it: inclusions, specified exclusions, and conditions governing exclusions. Inclusions are basic pay, dearness allowance, and retaining allowance. Exclusions are HRA, statutory bonus, value of house accommodation and utilities, employer contribution to PF, gratuity, conveyance allowance, travel concession, special work expenses, overtime, incentive, and retrenchment compensation. However, the exclusions may not exceed 50% of the total salary. If it does, such excess amount shall be deemed as wages. This is to ensure that companies do not adopt compensation structures which result in wages being reduced below 50% of the total remuneration. Wage payment timeline: daily basis, end of the shift; weekly basis, on the last working day of the week before the weekly holiday; fortnightly basis, before the end of the second day after the end of the fortnight; monthly basis, before the expiry of the seventh day of the succeeding month. Importantly, the wage period is not to exceed 1 month, and principal employer has to ensure clearance of contractor payment before the date of wage payment. So, the code envisages uniform applicability of the provisions of the timely payment of wages and minimum wages to all employees, irrespective of the wage ceiling and sector. Forms, registers and wage slip. Form 1, register of wages, overtime, fine, damages and loss. Form 2, application to appropriate authority by employee. Form 3, appeal by employer or employee. Form 4, employee register. Form 5, wage slip. Form 6, application for compounding of offence allowed upon payment of 50% of maximum fine amount. Offences and penalties. Among other penalties, there is a provision for imprisonment and fine up to Rs. 1 lakh for non-compliance, with higher penalties for repeated offences. We hope you enjoyed this broadcast. Stay tuned for our regular updates on EPF and labor laws. Subscribe to be notified each time we upload, which is very frequently, and check our channel page for multiple informative and motivational videos.